Welcome to the Vineyard Longmont online on Facebook or on YouTube. We're so glad that you joined us. My name is Donna Ackerman. I'm the worship pastor here, and this is Dietrich, one of my kiddos, joining me on Cajon. And we just wanted to come out to this place called Jim Hans Pond. And it was because of a World War II veteran that they built this place in his honor. And we're doing it because we love to worship Jesus outside in his nature and in Longmont. And we're going to be, Pastor Alex is going to be talking about Exodus and leading the people out of bondage. And we just thought that, man, this area with a pond behind us and even a Union Reservoir in front of us would be a good place for us to lead you into worship. So just take a moment and prepare your heart, and we'll get started. And we'll just thank you, Jesus, for who you are, Lord God. And we just put our eyes on you, Lord God. You are worthy to be glorified. Your name is to be glorified and be lifted up in this place, Lord Jesus. We thank you for fall and for new seasons. In Jesus' name, everybody said amen.
Shepherd, we rely on your good thing. Oh, you take us. Hey Vineyard, it's Alex. Welcome to church this morning, and we're happy to have you here. I've got Donna and Dietrich and Ethan behind me recording worship, which is what you just saw, of course, and we're just north of Longmont, and the skies are full of smoke. Fires are still burning, but it's a beautiful fall day today. Welcome to church. You're going to receive the offering. As always, there's three ways to give. You can give online at our website, vineyardlongmont.org. Hit the give button. You can give in person if you come to church with us. You can also mail checks in. You see the address there below. Let's pray for the offering. Lord, thank you that you love us and you're providing for us. Help us to live as if we're provided for and to live in the peace of that and in the obedience of that, that we would do things maybe others wouldn't do because of that truth. We love you, Lord. Thank you that we get to worship this morning in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, I just have a couple of quick announcements for you today. It's the 25th of October, and we're on week three of our series on the two-year Bible reading plan. If you want to follow us along through this, today, for example, we're in Exodus chapter 1 through 19, you can do so. If you want the schedule, just text me or email me, and I will get you the digital or a print copy of our schedule for the next 2 years. Love to have you joining with us. If you have questions or comments about the section we're reading as you read it leading up to this, please send them to me, and I'll always answer somebody's comment, at least at the live service. So, announcements today. Come and join us for live church. We're at 473 Main Street, just above a coffee shop called Vita Bella Cafe. And we got a neat little group. We just started a little over 3 months ago, about 30 people, and would love to be, for you to be a part of our new emerging worshiping community. Also, we have a Wednesday night discipleship program. It's called Seven Step. It's a different kind of program than maybe you're used to. It's studying and doing the disciplines to live out the life of Jesus as he's communicated in the Sermon on the Mount. So that's Wednesday nights at 6:30. We have a program and we have sponsors. Come and check it out. See if it's a fit for you. And finally, we'd love to have you join us on our Tuesday outreach. Every Tuesday night at 6 p.m., we deliver food to a neighborhood where it's a blessing to them. And so we've got a couple of neighborhoods now that we're approaching each week. It's just basically pure fun. If you're in the area and you'd like to join us, call me and I'll let you know where to come. Let's go to the message. God bless you guys. Hi Vineyard, welcome to church this morning. My name is Alex Ackerman. Today I'm speaking to you from the Flatirons in Boulder, halfway up Flagstaff Road at a place called Halfway House, interestingly enough. And it fits because we're going to talk about the next stage in the life of the people of God, the people of promise. And what we'll see is that, interestingly enough, they go through many of the same things that you and I go through. In fact, we probably ought to flip that around. That what happens in the first 19 chapters of Exodus, where we are in week three of the Bible in a Year program, is a type of the process that you and I go through in our journey from slavery to freedom. So let me give you the backstory here. By the time we get to chapter 19, after the Exodus, we find that the numbers are well over 600,000 people. And so the people of God are multiplying fast. And of course, 600,000 doesn't even come close to the number of stars that Abraham saw in the sky or the amount of sand that he saw on the ground, but it's certainly moving in the right direction. And what we're going to see this morning is a progression that these people go through that matches the story or the progression that you and I go through in our journey or our pilgrimage to follow God to the promised land. So I'm going to take you through several phases that the people of Israel go through. And then I want to pause at a key phase in chapter 3. The story begins in chapter 1 in slavery. And somehow God's people have gone from being on top, Joseph really running the entire nation, Pharaoh's chief administrator, kind of his vice president or his regent, to a few generations later, the Egyptians becoming intimidated because these people are growing so quickly that they no longer see them as guests or blessings, but they see them as a threat. Often when God blesses his people, those around them see them as a threat and as something to be protected from. And that's what happens here. And so the response of the Egyptians in the first couple chapters of Exodus is, these guys are growing, we better get them under control. So they make them slaves. They enslave the Israelites. And it tells us that the Israelites are building Pharaoh's cities. And so some people think the pyramids built during this time were built by God's people, now slaves. So the process begins in slavery and moves to the next phase, which is crying out. And the people of God are crying out to heaven, and they're crying out for quite a long time because they're being horribly treated, which takes us to the next phase of God choosing a deliverer in the proper time. And in this story, Pharaoh is trying to decrease the population of Israelites, and so there's a genocide of male infants going on. A woman has her child, Moses, and chooses not to throw him into the river, but to put him in a basket. And the Hebrew word for basket is actually the same word as for ark. And so catch the symbolism there. He's floating in an ark, in waters, escaping death. We see a very graphic picture of the blessing of God promised to Abraham's descendants, in that the very daughter of Pharaoh is bathing in the river and sees this pitched little basket with a little baby inside crying. And so she rescues the baby, knowing it must be an Israelite baby, and she pulls a woman nearby on the shore, which happens to be Moses' sister Miriam. Says, can you find someone to care for this baby? And Miriam goes and gets her mom, Moses' mom. And now Moses' mom is taking care of her baby at the orders of the daughter of Pharaoh. Well, Moses eventually grows up in the household of Pharaoh. And if you've seen the Ten Commandments or the Prince of Egypt, you know the story well. And so we see Moses himself as a type of the people of God who has to go through a process where he is in the world, in Pharaoh's household. He recognizes a crying out for deliverance from one of his countrymen, because he knows he's an Israelite. He murders the oppressor. Pharaoh finds out and he flees. And Moses runs into the desert and ends up connecting to some cousins, descendants of his ancestor Abraham, the Midianites. And as often is the case in these stories, he rescues and helps some women at a well. And that eventually leads to him marrying the daughter of one of the Midianites. And so Moses goes for 40 years. And that takes us to Exodus chapter 3, which I actually want to read. Now Moses was tending the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian. And he led the flock to the far side of the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. And by the way, Horeb is another name for Sinai. There the angel of the Lord appeared to him in flames of fire from within a bush. Moses saw that though the bush was on fire, it did not burn up. So Moses thought, I'll go over and see this strange sight, why the bush does not burn up. Let me pause there for a minute. So we have some very primal elements. We have God, we have fire, and we have a tree, or a form of a tree, a bush. Harkens back to the two trees in the garden once again. When the Lord saw that he had gone over to look, God called to him from within the bush, Moses, Moses. Let me stop there. What if Moses didn't look at the bush? Perhaps this is a sign of his preparation, that he's actually looking for things. He's paying attention to what's happening around him. And at any rate, there's a partnership happening here where God sees him respond and he calls his name. He calls his name, Moses. And Moses said, here I am. Do not come any closer, God said. Take off your sandals, for the place where you are standing is holy ground. Then he said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. At this, Moses hid his face because he was afraid to look at God. Ironic, and shows the beginning of Moses' journey with God, at least this phase of it, where he's afraid to look at God. And God goes on to describe how he has heard the cry of his people, suffering people, and he is preparing a deliverer, Moses, to go and rescue them. And they begin this conversation where in verse 11, Moses says to God, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt? And this begins a repetition of this phrase, I am or am I, that continues throughout this section. And God begins to reveal himself in a way more specific than he has to anybody else thus far. It says in verse 12, I will be with you. the first answer to the question of how am I going to do this. The phrase I will be is the exact same verbiage of how God is going to describe his name in a moment. And this will be the sign to you that it is I who have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you will worship God on this mountain. And so this is a phrase taking us from the beginning of Exodus to Exodus chapter 20 next week, when he is in fact on the mountain with the people of God in assembly. Moses said to God, suppose I go to the Israelites and say to them, the God of your fathers has sent me to you. And they asked me, well, what is his name? Then what shall I tell them? God said to Moses, I am who I am. It sounds like a non-answer. What's your name? Like, well, I am, kind of like, it is what it is, sort of a thing. I am that I am. And he continues to say, this is what you are to say to the Israelites. I am has sent me to you. And the phrase there, I am, in the Hebrew is ahiyeh. It's I am. It's this incredibly powerful phrase. It's an interesting name. I am that I am. God also said to Moses, say to the Israelites, the Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, has sent me to you. Now the word for the Lord might be familiar to you. It's in the Hebrew, Yahweh. And the Lord, or Yahweh, actually means I am, except it's in the third person. He is. And so we have this interesting play of words describing who God is. He describes himself as I am, that I am. Another way to think of that is I am self-sustaining. And you could think of this another way, that there's only one being in the universe that is completely self-sustaining. Everything other than God, the I am, that I feed into myself, I provide all power and strength and sustenance within myself. Every other creature cannot say that. All of us depend on other things to live. Ultimately, we depend on God himself to live because he provides everything. God is the one being that is completely self-sustaining. He's the source of life. He's life himself. He's also saying, when he says I am that I am, is that he's present. That in the present tense, I am. But what's happening here is God is defining his omnipresence. What do I mean by that? God is describing himself as the one being that is everywhere all the time. Not just everywhere presently, which is already mind-blowing. And by the way, there is only one being that is everywhere all the time. This is sort of a base level definition of who God actually is. His name defined by this characteristic that he's everywhere always. No other being can claim that, including other spiritual beings, including other gods. Demons cannot claim that. These poor little demons are localized to one little place at a time. Now, for those who are seeking God, whether they understand the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and ultimately expressed in his son, Jesus, who referred to himself as I am, at least eight times in the Gospel of John, clearly communicating his link to the Father. If you've seen the Father, you've seen me, Philip. Anyone who is seeking God finds him if they discern the being who is everywhere all the time, a God of love and compassion, a God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, ultimately God, the Trinity, the Father, the Son, Jesus, and the Holy Spirit. In fact, this whole thing works because God is everywhere all the time, reaching out to everybody. And so people of all ilks and faiths and backgrounds who are seeking God can find him because he's right next to them. He's everywhere all the time. And you know that they found him when they find the eternal presence. And so God says, I am. And then when we say his name, we're saying he is. The Lord is in the Hebrew, the phrase he is. Yahweh, as God defines himself as eternally present, past, present, and future. We respond almost like an echo back to him, saying his name, his holy name, saying that he is. He is the one who is everywhere, all the time. This is the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. It's an incredible thing. His name literally communicates his greatest character of permanence. And isn't it a wonderful thing that the permanent, omnipresent God is a God of love? And he shows this to his own people by rescuing them. And so it's through the communication of his name that God picks a fairly unremarkable person, someone who has no ability to speak, at a certain point, he says, look, use your brother. He's a good talker. I didn't pick you because you could speak. I picked you because you have the right character, because you're my deliverer to my people. At one point, when he says, well, how am I going to talk to Pharaoh? God actually tells Moses, look, you be like God to Pharaoh. And then your brother, Aaron, will be like Moses, will be like you to me. So you're giving the message as sort of representing God to your brother, who's the prophet, representing you, so that Pharaoh can get the message. The Bible later refers to us as kings and priests. And ultimately, a priest is someone who serves as an intermediary between man and God. And this is what Moses is doing. He's actually representing God. Now, when you and I receive the blessings of God and we understand some of these basic things about his good nature and we communicate those things to others, we are serving as Moses did to others so that they can receive the goodness and the blessing of God. It's an awesome privilege. We now move into sort of the confrontational section of Exodus. We see Moses confronting Pharaoh, let my people go. And he tells them this numerous times, and Pharaoh's heart is hardened. And we see kind of a type of interaction between us and the world around us that won't respond to God, that will not allow us to become free, even though God is the one freeing us. And so there's these 10 plagues that hit Egypt, and some of them are shared by God's people, and toward the end, many of them bypass God's people. And it's the process of us doing battle with the world around us to gain our freedom. And we can't think that our freedom will be easily won. Freedom is never easily won. Now, the 10th plague is the most intense one. It's the plague of the firstborn. And it's interesting that right on the brink of freedom, we see the death of firstborns in Egypt. We see the protection of God's people by the blood of the Lamb. It's called the Passover, the very feast that Jesus was celebrating when he commemorated the Last Supper. And his own blood was shed to cover and protect and to deliver his own people. Powerful imagery here of linking Moses and the people of Israel to Jesus and us. And ultimately, this death of a firstborn and this blood leads the people out of Egypt. And they're fleeing for their lives with the armies of Pharaoh following them. And God does this miracle. He has Moses touch the Red Sea with his rod, with his staff, and the sea parts, and the children of Israel pass through the water. Sort of full circle of the baby Moses passing through the water to life. Later on, you and I being baptized, passing through water to life. And the Israelites go all the way through on dry ground to the other side, and then the water fills back in, and the former oppressors of the people of God are now vanquished completely. And the world knows the greatest empire in the world at that time, completely defeated by, in a sense, a nameless God, a God who names himself by his characteristics, omnipresent. Later on in our next section, we'll talk about God further defining his character, and we'll see more, even more at that point, about who he is. Now, the rest of this section leading up to chapter 19 is the battle of people who are no longer slaves, working out their freedom in a way where they typically fall short through grumbling and complaining and disbelieving the things that God is asking them to do. And so God gives them this precious, precious gift right at the end of this section, and it's where it'll take us next week. God gives them a program for becoming like him, so they too can become the kind of people God can work with. And the program is called the Law. And that'll be next week, chapters 20 through the end of Exodus chapter 40. I hope you enjoyed reading that. For now, let's pray. Lord, thank you that the Israelites show us a pattern of our own journey from slavery to freedom and ultimately to the promised land. So Lord, help us to become the kind of people that can respond to your omnipresence, can respond to the reality that you're right next to us, your very name, and that we can love that reality as we flee our own darkness, our own slavery, and enter into our own places of freedom. In Jesus' name, amen. See you next week.